Bards, what did you get for Father's Day?
Got We Are Hawthorne, or whatever book came out last year, the Hard Way Mark II.
Oh, yeah? I got this.
Oh, every time you hit that, it plays a Hawthorne theme song. Do you know how annoying that is when you hit them all in the hawk's nest and everyone's standing in line keeps hitting them?
What is that meant to be?
Is that all they gave you?
No.
You're not held in very high esteem in your house, are you?
Means you've got the Hawthorne theme song on tap. What's wrong with that?
Exactly.
You're just the poor bastard that pays the mortgage and feeds the kids. No other use whatsoever.
This is when I want to shut you guys up. Or it could be the music in between.
You should use that tonight, just to shut Bards up.
Speaking of theme songs, did anyone see that Fred and Big Footy yesterday?
We should have a song.
If we should have a song pre-game like In Excess.
I suggested Hell's Bells by AC/DC.
Well, they played that last week.
Yeah, but how would you sing that? Hell's Bells!
They had the countdown of it last week.
It's a play on what the English football teams do.
Yeah, I know that's a play on what they do.
What song would you have then? Rap from Radio Birdman or something?
How about a bit of Radiators?
Screaming Jets are playing at the corner.
Are they?
Yes.
But they're a good band, Loz. I don't know if I could handle the corner. I'm a bit old for that sort of show.
You decrepit old bastard.
So, Adam, you were just saying that we should have a song like Port Adelaide at the very beginning of the game, but I reckon we had the perfect song through the last quarter. And I think it went along the lines of na-na-na-na, na-na-na-na, hey, 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 goodbye. And how good was that to sing to the Geelong supporters as they walked out about 10 minutes into that last quarter?
Don't ever sing again, by the way. It was really good. I enjoyed it, watching those poor, decrepit sods. Yeah, just through the course of the game, thinking they had some sort of chance as they mounted a couple of small comebacks during the first half and early in the third quarter, but quality won out in the end.
Bards, you went feral again.
Feral? Me?
Yeah.
What did I go feral?
In that last quarter, didn't you say something along, stick it up your go and get
That's just standard for a Geelong game. Lucky there was someone sitting in the seat in front of me, otherwise that would have copped it too.
Let's get into this show then. Geelong put the queue in the rack, Adam.
Don't know if they put the queue in the rack. I don't know whether it was mission accomplished from Chris Scott's point of view, though. They were just outclassed. I think Stevie Johnson played a very poor game, and I think he had a few mates. Stevie Motlop was going very poorly until he faked his injury, and he had some mates as well. And it was Joel Selwood versus the rest in reality.
You're saying Motlop was going fantastically well for us, punching the backboard?
It was chaos. Anyway, we better get on with this, Bards. Some scores, mate.
Okay, Hawthorn 15-14-104, defeating Geelong 10-8-68. Six goals, cop that.
Wedders, were you picking the margin or Hawthorn's score when you said 93 points last week?
93 points.
Or were you picking the margin for the Port Adelaide-Richmond game? I'm confused.
No, if we had had a go, we'd have won by 93 points. We won by six goals pulling up. It was like a barrier trial. It was disgraceful.
All right, goal kickers, Bards.
Lewis 3, Gunston 3, Roughhead 2, Puopolo 2, and singles to Smith, Hodge, Langford, Hale, and Bruce.
Well, before we get into 5-4-3-2-1, I reckon we do a bit of an assessment. What do you reckon of the players? Do something different. We've got plenty of time here. We don't have a game to review for next week. So let's start with Roughhead. A view out of 10, Wedders?
3. He was nonsense. Not his best game at all, but he'll bounce back.
Lewis. Bards?
Oh, he capped off the game well in the last quarter, so probably pushed himself up to a 6 or a 7.
Well, Sammy Mitchell? I give 8.
I think you're harsh, mate. I give him 9.5. He's a genius.
All right, well, Gibbo, how many did you give him?
6.
DeRay. Now, DeRay was an interesting one, Bards.
Yeah, I thought he played one of his better games for the club. He didn't have a lot of it, just the 12 possessions, but he did some good hard things, so probably a 7 from him.
Hard to displace, I think.
Yes, but there is a bit of a man love for suckling among the coaches, so I wouldn't count him out yet.
All right, well, Burgoyne, I give a 6.
He did some things that were worthy of a 10 when it counted, but yeah, not a huge game overall.
Hill, Weathers.
8. Made an absolute mess of the big Geelong boy with the supposedly elite running tank. Hill destroyed him and saw off one or two others in the process.
To be fair, I think Hill did break the beep test at the draft camp, didn't he?
Yeah, he smashed the clock.
Yeah, he probably had a 10 for the first half and maybe a 6 for the second, giving him an 8 overall.
Adam's favourite, Bards, Sewell.
I thought Sewell was good when he went forward and had a go at taking Enroy out of the game. Led him marked a few times, but not too bad. 6.
6, don't you dare. 9.5.
9.5? He only played 3 quarters.
Yeah, that's why he dropped half a point.
Didn't he struggle for the first quarter?
He's a legend. He's a hero.
All right, I give Birchall 6. Nothing flashy, did his job.
Yeah, maybe a little bit better than that, but didn't kill him.
Hodgie, Weathers.
5, he was ordinary early, but had a good second half.
Yeah, he looked like he needed to be subbed out there by half time, didn't he?
He looked like he should have been in the geriatric home.
But Isaac Smith.
Yeah, he gets an 8 along with Hilly, I think. Very important to us to play the ripper game. 7 inside 50s due to the run that he provides.
I get the pleasure of assessing Brian Lake and I give him 10. Stuck it up, Hawkins.
Gady found 8 for Mitchell and he gave him Lake 10.
Because he gave Hawkins a bath. You've got to give him 10 for that.
Yeah, the only goal Hawkins kicked was from a very dubious free that nobody actually believes was a free. I personally marked Lake and Mitchell similarly on the night. I thought they were our two best.
All right. Ben McAvoy's mate, Johnny Siegler, Weathers.
5 did his job. Think it's going to be very hard for the big boy to displace him now.
Gunstall Bards?
Yeah, best forward on the night, I thought. Probably a 7.
All right, I'll give David Hale a 7 as well. Solid. Bruce Weathers.
4. Did some nice things, didn't have a real impact on the game though.
Stratton Bards.
Strats was pretty good, I'll give him a 6.
6, the back line's got 6s all round so far except for Lake.
Tommy Hawkins should slip him a few bucks too for not going down when he belted him, because Hawkins got off and he shouldn't have.
Shields I give a 7, he was pretty consistent in the midfield. Weathers, Bards' love child, Spanger.
He gets a 7. Bit fumbly early, but I love the way the guy plays. He plays like a desperado, which is something young Mr. Schoenmakers could look at for future reference.
Does he stay on the side?
Absolutely, he stays in the side.
My favourite, Poppy, Bards.
Yeah, one of his quieter nights. 2 goals were handy, but didn't do a lot other than that, and even his tackle count was down, so 4.
Langford, I give a 7. Anyone dispute that one?
No, he's very good when he switched on a Salwood quad and him down in the second half. Kicked a ripper goal at the end.
Simpkin, Weathers?
Can't rate him. Wasn't on the park long enough. Didn't have an impact, but he only played 20 minutes of footy, so can't really give him anything.
Bards, that was our assessment all round, but you're the one with the votes that count, so for the Bardslow.
All right, I've given 5 to Sam Mitchell. I thought he had an all-round genius game. Decided he wanted to kick the ball this week and did that well. Some nice use of the body to set up a goal. Just ripped the game. 4 to Hill, especially his first half, the second half as well. The run he provided was huge. 3 to Lake for taking care of Hawkins, mainly because of what he's done to us in the past. 2 to Smith, mirroring Hill on the other wing, run and carry. And 1 to Liam Shields. Thought he had a real tough in and out of game and also laid 10 tackles on the night, which is huge in that hard game against Geelong.
Don't dispute any of that. It was pretty hard to fit all the players into a top 5, wouldn't you say, Adam?
Yeah, I think the votes are pretty much spot on. I thought Mitchell and Lake were the 2 best on ground, but I can see why Hill and Smith fought out the top votes as well.
Bards, got a blast?
I do, mate, believe it or not. For our old mates at the AFL, 2 years ago a great injustice occurred when we were forced to have a shorter break prior to the grand final, simply because ANZ Stadium was booked on the Friday night. You could argue that it might have cost us the grand final, considering Sydney ran over us at the end, but I think we had some other issues on that day as well. The AFL were apologetic, nothing they could do, they said. Well, now the football gods have handed the AFL a golden opportunity to right the wrongs of the past, having Sydney and Hawthorn playing the prelim again. So what did the AFL do? No sooner had the preliminary finalists been confirmed that the AFL issued their statement saying that Sydney would play Friday night, Hawthorn on Saturday. Didn't really expect anything else, but they even added in the little line in the press release. Sydney due to finishing on top of the ladder, get the right for the extra day's break. End of story. Really, we shouldn't expect much different from the AFL, but it would have been nice for them to give us a little nod and apologise for their past indiscretions. AFL is normal, run a rubbery rules policy, but we're used to that. But in the end, who cares? If we win this flag, it's going to be one of the best of all times, and we don't need any favours now. So stick it up and let's win it ourselves.
But we just had to bring that up, didn't we? Because 2012 still hurts a little bit.
It does, mate. And it's, look, it was outside the AFL's control because of the stupid scheduling with ANZ Stadium. And the fact that they're playing anything at that ground's a disgrace. But I didn't expect the AFL to change two wrongs don't make the right sort of thing. But it was an opportunity. They could have at least acknowledged the fact that it could have happened, but it won't. But they were very quick to point out that Sydney finished higher on the ladder by a massive 2%.
Is it out of the AFL's control, though, given Mike Fitzpatrick has a share in the ANZ Stadium? It beggars belief that we're supposedly running a professional sporting code and we have amateurs at the top making the decisions.
Oh, it's a huge conflict of interest. And I mean, Sydney have got a contract to play games at that ground, but I'd be turning around saying, if you can't produce a ground that's of a decent standard, we shouldn't be playing anything there. I think the new capacity SCG is enough, and that's where they should be playing their final. So
they got 35,000 of that game on Saturday.
Yeah, well, they would have 45 at the SCG.
Yeah, full house. Where does a whack?
Well, it's a preemptive whack, and I'm actually staying on the same topic that Bards has raised, albeit from a slightly different angle. And my preemptive whack is the Sydney Swans in general. Any AFL fan whose team is now knocked out of the competition, has taken up following the Swans as a second team, hoping that they win this year's premiership, needs to take a long, hard look at themselves. This is the AFL hand puppet. And by hand puppet, I mean the AFL have their hand jammed right up the Swans' rear end. 9.8% cola, the ability to recruit the likes of Tippett and Franklin. They get the softest draw ever dished out in the history of the game. Everything is absolutely gifted to the Sydney Swans, and any AFL fan that has any genuine hope that that mob wins this year's premiership should really take a long, hard look at themselves.
Yeah, yeah. There's all these other fours that kept coming up to us telling us how good a player Franklin is now that they've seen him at another club, and their Hawthorn hatred's gone.
Yeah, and I'm not suggesting these people should adopt Hawthorn as their second team. Any of the other three teams would be worthy winners because all the other three teams play within the rules that 17 other clubs have to play within.
Yeah, now that Essendon are out, you can say that.
Yeah, fair call.
All right, I'll go retrospective. So, from Friday night's game, and I'm going to go with Fairsuck of the Sav and Tonk of the Week. Now, Fairsuck of the Sav, if this guy wasn't an umpire, he'd be trying to get into the media and it'd be Tonga Week. But Ray Chamberlain, really, around the neck, mate, Poppy, you've got to have some sympathy. The two of you are about the same size, mate. When he gets tackled around the neck, it's around the neck. Call it, number one. Now, number two, don't try and justify the unjustifiable, if that's such a word. Mate, there was no left hand in Hawkins' back and the right hand was in the side. You looked at the screen and you went, how am I going to get out of this one? You got caught out with the whistle over in the Hawthorn game in South Australia and you've been caught out again. Absolutely fair suck of the Sav, Ray. You should not be umpiring. Tonk of the Week, Tom Arley. Now, the guy was trying to be unbiased, how good a Hawthorn, but how many times in 120 minutes did I have to hear him say, you've got to play 120 minutes against Hawthorn? I get it, Tom. I think everyone else got it. And if that's the only thing you're going to say in 120 minutes, then you better go and find another job, because you've got to have a few more strings to the bow than that, mate. So, Tom Harley, Tonk of the Week.
Boys, can I take the liberty now of just raising one more point? Seems apparent that you can literally belt the living suitcase out of someone, provided you've got a handful of jumper. How the hell did Tom Hawkins not get rubbed out for that?
Well, he obviously just can't punch. I just assumed there was no force. I bet anything his hands did or not.
Regardless of the force, though, under the edict of the MRP, it was high and it was behind play.
It was insufficient force to constitute a strike, according to the MRP.
Right. Yeah, okay. He's only 6'5" and 115 kilo. That wouldn't have hurt Stratton at all.
No. Yeah, crazy at finals time, and there's different rules in September, obviously. But there just seems to be a standard rule with jumper punches.
Oh, we're going to have a whole heap of kids now running around grabbing jumpers and throwing haymakers with a handful of jumper and getting away with it. Or thinking they can get away with it.
What Brian Lake should have done a couple of weeks ago was grab a handful of jumper first and then put his hand to it. Oh, hang on, that's what he did do. So you can punch someone in the jaw when you got hold of their jumper, but just don't hold onto the jumper because it'll look like you're choking them. And getting back to Razor Ray, you do know what he would be doing if he wasn't umpiring. Be on Big Brother. Because it's all about getting on TV for Razor. Pay a free kick, get me on TV.
All right, well, we've got to move on. We haven't got a game to preview for ourselves. But what we should do is consider, who are we going to play? Who are the Swans going to play? So let's start with, who are the Swans going to play? Adam, your favourite team. Who do they get to play in a week's time?
I said it since about round 18 or 19 when it was apparent that Geelong were going to finish in the top four. I think they're going out in straight sets, and I think the Swans will be playing North Melbourne.
But who are we going to play?
I think we'll end up with Freo. I think as good as Port were last week, over in the West, Freo will get that lockdown game going, and Port won't get that sort of run that the Tigers gave them, and I think they'll get the job done.
Yeah, I'd have to agree with both your selections. So, on that note, have a good weekend off in preparation for the forthcoming preliminary final, and go Hawks!
Go Hawks!